which way I'm going. I just know something is behind me. Something evil. So I run. It's bone chilling cold. I just want to wake up from this dream to find shelter. But there is none. To find light, but it's only dark. Then through the desolation, I feel hope. And as I get closer, I sense him waiting for me. His heart open. So I fall, shaking, shivering, to the Father's presence. He lets me stay there. He tells me everything is okay. There's nothing chasing me any longer. I am safe in my God. Eventually, he will release me and put me back in the world. But it won't be the same. Because he will be there with me forever. The way campfire smoke stays on my clothes. The way the touch of my childhood blanket could bring me back to a safe place. The way I'll never forget how to find my way home. Because he is my home. He is my refuge. I am protected. I am rescued. I have been through the dark night of the forest and I have found my way back. And he will never let me go.
I have decided. conferences on Monday and Wednesday of this week. As you can see in the bulletin, you can either contact Anita, and she will get the snacks from you, or bring them by the high school by 3, or drop them off in the morning here at the church.
Hey, young ladies, passing around the mission pennies, which is going to Cherry Street Youth Center this month. I'm going to pick on Julie Dillon here for a minute. Julie, are you a good mother?
Sometimes.
You know what a definition of a good mother is? It's someone that lets her kids lick the beaters. You know what a great mother?
Yeah, I'm not a good mother.
Well, this lady can go better. You know what a great mother is? Someone that turns the mixer off first. Okay, announcements this morning. We've already covered the treats for teachers.
Yeah.
Excuse me, if you're interested in helping with that, we'll get a hold of Anita. Devotions with Dorothy. Has taken a hiatus here for a while Dorothy was recovering, and she evidently has decided she's going to start that up again at 9 a.m. on Wednesday, except the venue is going to be changed. It's going to be at the Guest Home Estates. So if you'd like to participate in that, well, March 13th on Wednesday, she'll be devotions with Dorothy. Palm Sunday egg hunt is coming up on April 14th. And they're asking for donations of candy again, and candy should be individually wrapped, and no chocolate, please.
Wait a minute.
That's what it says here. I'm just reading.
Last year, remember, I made a plea that anybody that wanted to bring chocolate, I would take it.
You'd take it? Okay, well, I say, all I'm doing is reading what it says here, Jim. So, you know, you can make a dent to that if you want to. Red Cross Blood Drive is coming up this week. It's on Tuesday from 1 to 6:30 p.m. and Wednesday from 9 a.m. to 1 p.m. and that will be at Central Park Pavilion. If you're able to donate blood, we encourage you to do that. And there it says there's going to be a special Game of Thrones promotion for donors, and see the Chanute Tribune for further details. So, Easter Lily Memorials, if you want to do a monetary donation, it will be accepted to add your loved one's name to the Easter Lily Memorial List. Please be sure to contact church office. And money collected is used to help purchase additional artificial plants as needed. Excuse me. Pantry Sunday coming up. Challenge for March. Get your diapers and feminine products. And cash is also greatly appreciated and needed if you would like to donate to the pantry. Builders Class Sunday School will be starting a new quarter this coming Sunday. The study will be called to discipleship, called to ministry, and called to life of Christ. If you're interested and want to join them, they're going to meet in Linda Arnett's old office and Linda Jay's new office, just off of the fellowship hall. And then I've already covered mission papers. So is there anybody else that has any announcements this morning?
The worship committee is meeting on the 21st, which is a Thursday, spring break coming up. I don't know that is going to conflict with any of you going to the beach, some sandy beach somewhere. But that's what the plan is. For Thursday, the 21st, worship committee meeting.
Okay.
5:30.
All right. Anyone else this morning? Doesn't look like. If not, you can stand up and pass a piece to your neighbor.
Good morning.
sometimes by a pond. Were you scared at all while you were camping? You got stuck by a bumblebee. So there was, you know, sometimes when you're out camping, there's things out there that can sting you. You know, I love to camp. You do? I like to camp, but sometimes there are things out in the wilderness that scares me. Bumblebees, as most people know, spiders. I don't handle spiders very well, nor snakes. And sometimes if you hear a coyote howling, that might be a little scary. There are things out in the wilderness that can scare us. Well, today we're going to hear about a scripture lesson that Jesus, after he was baptized, he was driven into the wilderness for 40 days. He was out in the wilderness for 40 days. Now, he's tempted out in the wilderness. He is hungry, he's thirsty, he's dirty, he's tired. And you know, he still stayed close to God, and he relied on God to take care of him. And God did it. So whenever we are scared, or if we feel like we're in the middle of nowhere and we have nothing, we can always call out to God to take care of us. Will you bow your heads and repeat this prayer with me? Almighty God, thank you for watching over us. Amen. See you next week.
Would you please stand with me now for our call to worship? Let us rejoice in the Lord. Through the Spirit we are born into the family of God.
And the universe of God.
The witness of the Spirit confirms us.
The wisdom teaches us.
The power enables us.
The
have to mention that. Anybody else have anything this morning?
You do.
I'm happy to say that my daughter's doing very well after her surgery.
Good. I think Dr. Don had one here for us. I have.
Yes, I have a joy.
Nothing subtle about him, is it? Any other joys or concerns this morning?
Tamara's like that there in the back.
I'd like to look at my sister-in-law, Dory. She's having some tests right now, and then my mother is having cataract surgery this week. Mm-hmm.
Anyone else this morning?
Well, of course, I have the joy of being back and having Maddie back. The scariest moments, of course, were when you're in your own grandpa's funeral and you get the text that your wife is going being flown on that flight into Wichita. And that ride there, I knew it was really just more precautions than anything, but still, there's a chance we could have, I've lost her. So that was the scariest moment. And maybe when she was coming off the sedatives, that was a little scary. But, you know, I take joy in knowing that God is always with us. He's always with us. After that moment, she arrived there at the hospital, the burn unit, and ICU, and at St. Francis. I never doubted for a moment we were going to be okay once she was there. I knew everything was going to be all right. But, man, it was a joy. You guys, my family, our family, never left us. You guys have blessed us in so many ways. I consider to say thank you, thank you, thank you. I'll repay you in some form, somehow, I will do it. But I'm telling you right now, thank you so much for all of you that continue to reach out to us. Because she still has some recovery, as much as she probably doesn't want to admit it. She wanted to go back to work on Monday. The doctor said, I don't think you should do that because of so much illnesses going around. So, but she is really wanting to get back in the public. She got to go have coffee with Marsha Carter this week, so she's ready. So, from her and I, thank you so much. You're filled with so much joy. Thank you.
All right. Anyone else this morning?
And I will just say, Paul, the way that you just stated, I will repay you one day. How you touch this congregation each and every Sunday, you're already doing. Thank you. Let us then go to the Lord and prepare our hearts with our hymn, Seek Ye First. Some of us struggling with depression or the uncertainty of the future. Dear my God, we come and we lay all these things before you, knowing that your will in our lives is for us to be close to you and fill your love, fill your joy, fill your hope. As we come this day, we come lifting up in prayer that perfect prayer that your Son taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. And now, with the joy of giving in our hearts, let's offer our tithes and our offerings.
Instant all the kingdoms of the world. And the devil said to him, to you
your Lord, your God, to the test. The devil had finished every test. He departed from him until the opportune time. This is the word of God. Thank you. Now you may be
seated. Let us pray. Almighty God, may the words of my mouth, the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in your sight. Lord God, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. The phrases I could have, I should have, or I would have, sometimes is the most bitter phrases that can never be said. Have you ever felt that way? More than that, how many of you at nighttime thinks about the events of the whole day going, man, if I could have, if I should have, if I would have just done something a little bit different, today would have went better. Anybody ever done that? Okay, good to know that I'm not the only one. It is part of life. These feelings can be so frustrating. In a book written in 1989, Overcoming Regrets, Mistakes, or Missed Opportunities, Freeman DeWolf looks at the two questions. First, what prevents us from doing the woulda, coulda, shouldas in our lives? And secondly, how do we deal with the woulda, coulda, shoulda feelings of despair and guilt? How do we do that? How do we deal with bad decisions that keeps us from taking chances or making any choices in our present that will affect our future? How do we deal with these? It is how we come to deal with these vulnerable experience in our lives that helps us to be better people. We have got to learn to not act on our feelings in the moment. And that is hard. Now, to those out there that have children, that sees a child react quickly when they're angered, what are some of the responses out there? Just the other day, as soon as Andrew came out of his surgery, his reaction was to be upset. Martin's reaction was to tell him to be quiet and quit crying. As soon as we got home, Andrew wanted to play with his favorite toy. Martin's reaction was, I want to play with that toy because you're playing with it. Other reactions are, you hurt me, therefore I am going to hurt you. These are behaviors that are, I think, born into us from the beginning of time. When I was in college, I was a philosophy major. I love studying philosophy. One of my favorite philosophers was Augustine. Augustine wrote in his Confessions, a book called Confessions, that when we are born with original sin. That is when he first started looking into what it really meant to be born as sinful. And he wrote that when we are children, we learn right away, if we cry, we get fed. Now, I don't know so much all about that. That we all want what we want when we want it. But I truly believe that what we want is we don't want to hurt other people. We don't want to do things badly. We don't really want to be bad people. I want to say that is right and correct for 99.9% of us. Now, in this week's gospel lesson, see that Jesus is being tested. He had been taken out, driven by a spirit into the wilderness. For 40 days, he goes without food, without drink. Now, 40 days, it might have meant 40 days, but when it comes to the translation, he was out there for a long time. He is hungry, he is thirsty, he's tired. The first thing that the devil taunts Jesus is trying to coerce an emotional reaction. There are three types of reactions that we all have built into us. The first one that Jesus has to deal with is an emotional reaction. After his 40 days, he was hungry. So his emotions are getting the best of him. And the devil says, take that rock and turn it into bread. Get yourself something to eat. It will be good. But Jesus shows he is more than just a hungering stomach. He is faithful and he is disciplined. He is the Son of God, seeking divine closeness and spiritual comfort through fasting. And Jesus shows this through his emotional response and says, I am more than just hunger. It is okay that I am hungry, because what matters most is that I am close to God. And then the devil's second temptation appeals strongly to Christ's cognitive thinking side of things. The devil lures Jesus through riches, power, and authority. He entices Jesus to think through things reasonably. He just bows before him. He can have all of this. He'll have comforts. But Jesus has further compassion in his life. Jesus is still rational. He doesn't think the way the devil wants him to think. Instead, he says, no. No. And then, when the devil purchased Jesus on the pinnacle of the temple, he has tempted him to respond in a behavioral way. Throw yourself down. And it says in the scriptures that the angels are going to save you. And Jesus finally had enough. And he says, leave me. Get away from me. You see, Jesus was disciplined in a close walk with his Father. You see, Jesus was both divine and human. Jesus had to deal with humanly things on this earth. He was tempted. He was driven. He was made to want to be fed. He was hungry. But he resisted it all. He could have ate the bread. He should have, would have, possibly took the easy way out and bowed down to Satan, which would have kept him from a life on the cross. But it would have kept him from saving the world. So in our lives, how do we choose the right path in our daily walk? How do we choose to say nice words and words that might hurt somebody that we are mad at? How do we choose to reach out and give a handout to someone in need than just ignoring them and walking on? These are part of a disciplined walk with Christ. That takes a lot of practice. Throughout these 40 days of Lent, I have decided to try to grow closer to God. That's what we are all called to do through these 40 days. 40 days. And I've taken on rereading some of my seminary books that I loved while I was going through seminary. And one of my favorite writers is Barbara Brown Taylor. This was one of my favorite books, Home by Another Way. And in it, she has a chapter called Spiritual Lenten Disciplines. And in this chapter, she describes, she says that Lent, you can't find it anywhere in the Bible, and you can't. There is no word in the Bible for Lent. It's not there. But throughout time, when the disciples kept on waiting for Jesus and waiting for Jesus to return, and he did return in the manner that they were seeking, they began to turn to some earthly ways. They got lazy in a matter of sense. They started seeking comforts of life than being disciplined. So what happened is years, decades, centuries later, Lent came around. At first, it was meant to be 40 hours of fasting before Easter. From Good Friday to Easter, they would fast. But then it grew into 40 days as a time where we are to look deep inside ourselves and see what we could have, should have, and would have done different throughout the year. Like, could you, should have, and what you do in order to grow closer to God? The church announced a season of Lent. Now, Lent means spring. That's what it means. Spring. It's not only a reference to the season before Easter, but an invitation to spring your soul. Get your soul in order for the coming of Christ. I want you throughout these 40 days with me as we go through a sermon series. We're going to be looking at different disciplines, different things we can do throughout this season that will help us to grow closer to God. Different things that we can do that will continue on in us. Help changing our emotional state, our behavioral state, and the way that we respond rationally or unrationally. We won't be rational when we have those things in front of us that we struggle with. I hope that you will all join me as we dive into this and try to be stronger disciples for God. Let us pray. Almighty gracious Lord, we pray that you will help lead us and guide us. Help us to grow closer to you. Help our women should have could have us, so that we have less of those throughout this year. Instead, help our behavior, help our thinking, help our emotional state have you as the forefront, so that we can grow as closer disciples of Christ. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.